finding treasure. I am so glad to see you guys here today. Why don't you stand and we will start with Psalm 27. It says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Who is there to fear? The Lord is my fortress. Who is there to be afraid of? Evildoers closed in on me to tear me to pieces. My opponents and enemies stumbled and fell. Even though an army sets up camp against me, my heart will not be afraid. Even though a war breaks out against me, I will still have confidence in the Lord. I have asked one thing from the Lord, this I will seek, to remain in the Lord's house all the days of my life, in order to gaze at the Lord's beauty and to search for an answer in his temple. He hides me in the shelter when there is trouble. He keeps me hidden in his tent. He sets me high on a rock. Now my head will be raised above my enemies who surround me. I will offer sacrifices with shouts of joy in his tent. I will sing and make music to praise the Lord. I believe that I will see the goodness of the Lord in this world of the living. Wait with hope for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart be courageous. Yet wait with hope for the Lord." What a psalm of encouragement. Amen? Amen. Let's begin with redeemed. And that's just what this psalm says, is that Christ has redeemed us.
Set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain, cause I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. All my life I've been called unworthy, named by the voice of my shame and regret. But when I hear you whisper, child, lift up your head, I remember, oh God, you're not done with me yet. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain, cause I'm not who I used to be.
Because I don't have to be the old man inside of me, cause his day is long dead and gone. Because I've got a new name, a new life, I'm not the same, and a hope that will carry me home. I am redeemed. You set me free.
So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain, cause I'm not who I used to be.
I am redeemed. You set me free.
So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain, cause I'm not who I used to be. Oh God, I'm not who I used to be. Jesus, I'm not who I used to be.
I am redeemed. Thank God, redeemed. Why don't you turn and greet one another in the name of the Lord?
Well, good morning. It is great to welcome you to the house of the Lord today. Are you doing well? Well, I heard some grumbles, a few. How many of you are Irish this morning? They have told me I have no green on. Trust me, I do. And I do have a green mark on my finger, so there we go. I've been greened. It's a good thing. And since I'm part Irish, in that mutt makeup of my lifestyle, I better have green. It's pretty bad when we even have green on the screen. Wow. Well, hey, it's good to see you this morning. Hope you are ready to worship the Lord and have a great, great day. A couple of quick announcements I need to share with you. There's some information for the ladies there that if you'd like to be a part of Women's Council, we're having a time on March the 30th at 2, making plans for a ladies' event, and we encourage you to come, ladies, and be a part of that. We also want you to know that this Friday, Fun After 50, we'll be going to Jim's Chicken here in town, and we'll meet there at 6, and I encourage you to be a part of that. Cards are needed today. There's information there in our ministry to the Schilling School. This month we're doing the restaurant cards, and if you can help out with that, we really need those today. You can let us know, and we'd be glad to have those and take care of that. Palm Sunday brunch, just encourage you to be mindful of that time. We're going to be doing a brunch at 9:30. Want you just to bring the kind of stuff you'd eat at a brunch, so egg casseroles, whatever, stuff like that. And it'll be a great opportunity to invite friends, family, neighbors, those that you'd love to just reach out in faith to for a great morning, and then we'll come in and worship at 10:30, 10:45, and it'll be a great, great, great day. Tonight, service will be here in the sanctuary instead of over on the fellowship hall side. We're going to meet over here on this side because we're showing a video from our M19 conference that I think you'll want to see. Pretty powerful presentation from a guy by the name of Ed Stetzer, who currently is the interim pastor at the Moody Bible Church in Chicago, just doing a great work there, but you'll enjoy that time together. It is a great morning to worship the Lord, amen? Have you enjoyed some spring-like weather? Yeah, well, you know, it's kind of interesting. I have been following the snowstorms back home. During the last week, parts of Colorado got up to 90 inches of snow. So wouldn't that be fun? Oh, I think it'd be so much fun. But that's just me. I don't mind snow at all. So you did know that it was supposed to snow this weekend here, and then the weatherman decided he was going to get it right for once and changed it and said we'll have sunshine. So thank the Lord for a wrong weatherman. And we're going to celebrate the Lord. I don't know about you, but I absolutely love Sunday mornings. I get up and I take quiet time with the Lord early, and then come to the church. And I'm always here to hear the worship team prepare for service. And then I get to see you, and it's just like, this is just a great, great day. This morning I got up thinking that wonderful verse from Psalm, "This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." And this morning I just encourage you to put on your happy shoes. Put a smile on your face, okay? Because some of you are looking pretty somber this morning. It's like, I hope you didn't get up on the wrong side of the bed. But put on your happy face and let's just stand together and let's celebrate and worship the Lord.
Well, later, I didn't get a chance to go say hi to Trudy earlier, but I want to tell you that I do listen when you talk. And about a year ago at this time, she said, "You know, I would love to do this song, Death Was Arrested." Well, today's your day. It's not next, but it's coming. I'm just telling you. We're going to start getting back in the scripture at Philippians 3. It says, "Brothers and sisters, imitate me and pay attention to those who live by the example we have given you. I have often told you and now tell you with tears in my eyes that many live as the enemies of the cross of Christ. In the end, they will be destroyed. Their own emotions are their God, and they take pride in the shameful things they do. Their minds are set on worldly things. We, however, are citizens of heaven. We look forward to the Lord Jesus Christ coming from heaven as our Savior. Through his power to bring everything under his authority, he will change our humble bodies and make them like his glorified body." Amen? As we sing Diamonds, that is exactly what he's doing, is changing us from the mess up that we are to the bodies that Christ has for us. Amen.
Here and now I'm in the fire and above my making diamonds out of us.
Oh, the joy of the Lord, it will be my strength. When the pressure is on, he's making diamonds.
Oh, the joy of the Lord, it will be my strength. When the pressure is on, he's making diamonds. Oh, the joy of the Lord, it will be my strength. When the pressure is on, he's making diamonds. Diamonds making us rise up from the dust. He is refining, and in his timing, he's making diamonds out of dust. Making diamonds out of us. I won't be afraid to shine. I won't be afraid to shine. I won't be afraid to shine. 'Cause he's making diamonds out of dust. Making diamonds out of us.
Well, God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
This morning we want to take some time as we pray to go to the Lord and lift the Owens family. Friday morning at 10:30, we'll be having Gene Owens' funeral service here. Just be in prayer for Pat and all of the family. If you're able to help with the food items, you can let Joy know. Joy's having to work this morning, so she's gone. You could let her know, give her a call or text. And also, we're going to need some ushers that day. If you're able to come, or gals, and help us out with that. We do appreciate your help this week. There are lots of other needs in our church family today. Lots of folks have been struggling and lots of illness and things going on. It's great to look back and see Joe Cobb this morning. It's great to have you with us. And we're going to celebrate the Lord this morning as we come to him in prayer. If you have a special need, you know that every Sunday morning we open the altars just as a place to come and get alone with the Lord. Maybe today you just need to praise him, to say thank you for what he's doing in your life. As we come to the Lord, let me just invite you to open your hearts to him and celebrate his goodness in his presence.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever comes before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. strength is failing. The end draws near and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never. Worship your holy name. Yes, I will worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never before. I worship your holy name. Yes, I will worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name.
Father, we hear in those words the word of the psalmist. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Praise His holy name. Today we come before You in the name of Jesus, entering boldly into Your presence, thankful for the blood of the cross, thankful for the invitation, thankful for the opportunity to stand in Your presence. Hear the praises of Your people this morning as we lift our hearts to You now in praise. Father, seeing how You have been at work in so many people's lives, in my life this morning, causes me to say thank You, to praise You. And in the midst of that, to recognize how truly unworthy each one of us is to receive Your grace, to merit even this opportunity to come into Your presence. And we recognize, Lord, this morning that we are not here because we deserve to be. We're not here because we're so good that You have no choice but to accept us. We're here because when we were at our worst, You were at Your best. And You sent Your Son to make it possible for us to know peace, to receive forgiveness, and to be granted a welcome into Your presence in prayer. And Father, this morning, as we think about all You've done, it gives us encouragement to know that You are a God who's active, who's intimately acquainted with all of our ways, who knows our needs before we speak them. And yet, God, as an act of submission, we lay our needs before You. And this morning, as we come to You in prayer, we now confess our needs and say, God, hear the places, hear the people, hear the things where we need Your help today. Hear the prayers of Your people. Thank you. Father God, in anticipation of the message this morning, I consider that one truth, Lord, that wherever we are, there you are present, inviting us to come. But as a perfect gentleman, you say to us, you'll not force your way into our lives. You'll not force us to respond. We must come willingly, saying, God, we need you. And so prepare our hearts today to receive from your word, to hear the overtures of your grace and your love, to respond to that still small voice of the Holy Spirit. That God, whatever you want to do in our lives this day, in this house of worship or online as folks are worshiping with us, that today, God, we could submit and surrender to you. And we could allow your perfect peace and your awesome grace to come into our hearts and lives and do a new thing. Hear our prayers, Lord. And know that our desire is to worship you. We come now, Lord, in our time of worship to that place where we say thank you in a tangible way. As we offer to you, Lord, our tithes and our offerings, and in so doing say thank you for the many, many, many ways that you bless us. Today, God, we give out of full hearts, recognizing that once again you have cared for our needs, that once again you have provided for everything that we are needful of. And the way in which we say thank you is to respond obediently as stewards. And so we offer to you today our tithes and our offerings, and in so do say thank you for caring for our hearts and our lives. Thank you, God, for being with us today. Help us as we continue to worship to see Jesus, in whose name I pray. Amen.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope and no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began, oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a no more. My shame was ransomed, he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began, love pouring down on Our Savior is slain on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began.
Jesus told that man, that thief that he was hanging next to. And you know what? It was drastically different than what he told me. You see, the day that I encountered Jesus, I dropped to my knees right in front of him. He had my respect from the start. You see, I wasn't looking for a handout, okay? I explained to him that I had done the hard work. I just needed to know, was there something that I was missing? Was there some good thing that I needed to do in order to inherit eternal life? And you know, sell all that you own. That's what Jesus told me. Sell it all, and you'll have treasure in heaven. Yeah, right. You see, I was always taught that salvation is a reward for a life that is filled with good works. It is not a handout that you give to people that can't muster up... that can't muster up enough character to earn it themselves. My wealth is a clear indication of the favor that rests upon me from God. I had asked about eternal life, and this disgusting shell of a man, he's the one that gets it? Jesus told him the day he died, he would be in paradise. This man couldn't bleed a drop of goodness that he hadn't borrowed. No, that he hadn't stolen from the righteous man that he's hanging next to. He was a thief, and I'm the one that is treated like I've been robbing God all along. I offered to do what I needed to do. This man offered nothing. All he could do was ask for mercy. And that's how he got salvation. That's how he got eternal life. It was just given to him. It was a gift.
It was just given to him. Like it was a gift. It is, isn't it? This thing we call eternal life. I mean, after all, Jesus spoke into the heart of the Apostle Paul who said that the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. And there it is in one simple sentence. The free gift of God is eternal life in Jesus. Last week, we began a series of messages that are going to take us through the last words of Christ on the cross. And in the process of that message, I shared with you this truth that when we encounter Jesus, he not only meets our needs as we perceive them, but he also meets the needs he sees in our hearts. It's one thing to come to the Lord and say, here are my needs, God, and pour out that list. But it's a completely different thing for him to do the examination and say, above and beyond all that you think, here's what I know you really need. Which brings me to the second truth that comes from these last words from the cross. And that is that when we need him the most, Jesus is right there. He's always present. He's always among us. He is always right where we are all the time. But the question we have to answer is, will we open our hearts to him? I mean, it's one thing for him to be present. It's another thing for us to receive that presence and experience all that he has to give. Mark chapter 10 shares with us the incredible story of the rich young ruler. And in this passage of scripture, I want to read it to you this morning, and I want to share with you just a couple of thoughts before we move to our real text, which is over in Luke chapter 23. But in Mark chapter 10, we read that Jesus was setting out on a journey, and a man ran up to him and knelt before him and began asking the question, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Now, before we go any further, let me explain something here. Under the Jewish religious culture, faith is a work of the hands, not a work of the heart. 1999, I was in Israel with Rabbi Mendel Abrams, and he and I were actually at the Western Wall, the Wailing Wall, and we had been praying together. And as we walked away from the wall and began to discuss the experience that we'd had there, I looked at Rabbi and I said, "Rabbi, help me understand the real difference besides Jesus between your faith and mine." And this Jewish rabbi looked at me and he said, it's very simple, John. You live a relationship from the heart. I live a relationship from the hands. I must earn my way into the presence of God. I must earn my way to find God's favor. I must make certain that I do enough to warrant eternal life. You just simply open your heart and receive. There's the difference. What Rabbi was echoing to me is exactly what this young, rich man was living with Jesus. What do I have to do to inherit eternal life? Jesus responds, and he says, first of all, why in the world do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. And you know the commandments. And he begins this recitation. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not bear false witness, do not defraud, honor your father and mother. And the young man said to him, teacher, I have kept all of these things from my youth up. And looking at him, Jesus felt love for him. I want you to hear that. He didn't feel judgment. He didn't feel condemnation. He didn't feel anger. You're really good. You anticipated well. Thank you. The joy of being a diabetic on Sunday mornings. He looks at him and he loves him. How often do we encounter people in our own lives who maybe aren't living the way that we think they ought to, or at least are not measuring up the way we think they ought to measure up? How often do we look at them with love rather than judgment? How often do we look at them and say, you know, you're just not making the grade? Jesus looks at him and has love in his heart. And he says to this young man something very interesting. There's one thing you lack. Go and sell all you possess and give it to the poor, and then you'll have treasure in heaven, and then come and follow me. You see, Jesus knew something about this young man when he looked into his heart that was incredibly important. Something had a hold of him. You heard it in the video drama. He makes this statement, my wealth proves that I have the favor of God. Wealth doesn't prove anything, except maybe you were in the right place at the right time, or you inherited it, or you just plain worked hard. That's where wealth comes from. Now, does God bless? Yeah, God blesses. But wealth is something we derive. The wealth he has to give has nothing to do with the stuff we acquire. Verse 22 of Mark 10 has painful words in it. He says that these words, his face fell. And the young man went away grieved, for he was one who owned much property. And Jesus, looking around, said to his disciples, how hard it is for the rich man or the wealthy to enter the kingdom of God. His disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus answered again and said to them, children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Now let me stop. Do you know what the eye of the needle is? Yeah, it's this little entrance into the city through the gated walls. Now, I know what you were thinking. You were thinking that little metal thing that you stick string through and you stitch with. That's not what he's talking about. In all of the walled cities in Israel at that time, there were these narrow entry points where you could enter the city as a single man turning sideways. Troops couldn't get in. Camels couldn't get in. Warriors couldn't get in. It was a very tight little place where you could enter when the gates were closed at night. When he makes this statement, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle. The disciples, they understand that's physically impossible. It's an amazing picture. And the disciples, it says, verse 26, were even more astonished and said to him, Jesus, then who can be saved? And looking at them, Jesus made this simple statement. He said to them, with men it's impossible, but with God all things are possible. I read those words and I'm instantly reminded of this incredible truth that has with it a question. When we need him the most, he's right there. But will we open our hearts to him? This young ruler came to Jesus and all he wanted to know was what he needed to do. And Jesus said to him, you know, you've done almost everything right. You're living a life of obedience. You're following the teachings of Scripture. You're going the right direction. But there's one thing, just one thing, that holds you back. You see, for all you've done right, you're still gripped by something. And in his case, it was wealth. And as long as that wealth had hold of his heart, there would be no room for Jesus. And so Jesus says, let it go. Give it away. And then come and follow me. Let me ask you a really personal question this morning. What's your one thing? What's the one thing that keeps you from radically following Jesus? The one thing that gives you a pause, that makes you hold back, that keeps you from saying, Lord Jesus, you've got my all. What's your one thing? Now, some of you may be thinking in your heart, Pastor, there is no one thing. Jesus has my everything. And I thank the Lord if that's who you are. But I think often for every one of us, there's a one thing. One thing that gets in the way. One thing that keeps us from following fully. And yet, when we need Jesus the most, even when that one thing has a grip on our souls, he's right there. And the question we have to answer is, will we open our hearts to him? Jesus taught this young man, and he teaches us life's most significant spiritual lesson. It's found in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, where in the God's Word translation, we read, God saved you through faith as an act of kindness. You had nothing to do with it. But being saved is a gift from God. It's not the result of anything you've done, so no one can brag about it. Now there's some real heavy spiritual words there, this concept of being saved. What Paul's trying to say to us there is this: if you want a relationship with Jesus Christ, and you want to know that when your life comes to an end, you will be in heaven with him forever, you're going to have to recognize you can't earn it. You don't deserve it. It's a gift from God. Hearing the words that Jesus said, understanding the price tag, the one thing was too much to let go of. And Mark records that he was disheartened. He was grieved. And he walked away. And sadly, too often, so do we. What's your one thing? What's the one thing in your life that would keep you from saying an absolute, unqualified yes to everything that God is asking from you? What's the one thing? This morning, James Davis, our former youth pastor, is stepping into a pulpit. I was there the Sunday in Emporia when he came back from a mission trip to Mexico, where he had gone to help build a house with his daughters. He was living his dream. He was teaching school. He was enjoying what he was doing. He was having fun. But he went to Mexico, and in the midst of serving in a missionary position for a few weeks, he realized that there was one thing he'd never let go of, and that one thing was saying yes to God's will for his life. You see, James had wrestled with the call to ministry for a long time. He'd just always believed that God could use somebody else. In other words, and let me make this really clear, in other words, he was simply saying, Lord, I'm going to do what I want to do. And he confronted that one thing. And for a number of years now, he has been walking this journey of faith, developing the skills, the talents, the resources, understanding everything that it was going to take for him to continue following Jesus. And in the midst of that, he surrendered. And look what God has done with him. And the same is true of Daryl Riffle, another pastor on the district who's gone out from us and is doing an incredible job in ministry in Larned. The same thing's true of Luke Wise, who's down in Ark City. You see, they dealt with the one thing, and when they dealt with the one thing, it opened up a world of possibilities for them that God was able to do more than they ever asked or imagined. What is this morning your one thing? Mark 10:26 asks the question, who then? How is it possible? What's it going to take for us to be saved? You see, they're looking at it from the perspective of, I've got to do something. I've got to measure up. I've got to find a way to please God. And now suddenly Jesus is saying, that's not what it's all about. It's about letting go of the one thing, surrendering, recognizing that you must give him your heart. And they don't get it. They don't understand. And so Jesus adds this, with man, what I'm asking seems and is impossible. But not so with God. You see, for him, all things are possible. In other words, if you just surrender the one thing, everything I have to offer will be yours. Jesus wants us to see the truth, that when we need him the most, he's there. But will we open our heart to him? Fast forward a couple years. Luke 23 records the story of Jesus on the cross. It's a horrible, terrible day. At this point in the journey, Jesus has been tried, convicted and sentenced to death. Those who had followed him have made the decree, crucify him. He's been beaten and scourged and led out of the city. They've made him carry the cross member until he could carry its weight no more. They have bound it to the upright. They have nailed him to it. They have dropped it into the hole, and now Jesus is hanging there. That's where we pick up the story. Luke 23 and verse 39 says that one of the criminals who were hanged there was hurling abuse at him, saying, "Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us." There is this sense in his words, but he's demanding what he isn't due. And continue the mocking and the abuse that Jesus had endured on that whole pathway to Golgotha. The other answered, Luke 23 and verse 40, and rebuked the first and said, "Don't you even fear God, since you're under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed are suffering today for what we've done. It's a just suffering. We're receiving what we deserve for our deeds, but this man with us has done absolutely nothing wrong." Now I want you to hear that clearly. This other criminal on the cross recognizes that Jesus has been convicted falsely. He's there for no evil deed of his own. And this man recognizes that. And then he looks at Jesus and he says something that anybody in his position would want to say, but he says it with an intensity that communicates he understands the cost. "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Truly I say to you, today you'll be with me in paradise." I want to walk through these verses and see what we learn. First of all, notice that Jesus was surrounded on the cross by true criminals. Now it's interesting. We've always called them thieves, the two thieves on the cross. The Greek language is a rather precise language, and what's interesting is the word that's used there that we often translate thieves doesn't mean thieves. It actually means evil working people. These guys are masters of doing evil deeds. They're not just common thieves who steal and take advantage of others. These men provoke and bring evil everywhere they go. They're not just bad men, they're evil men, they're despicable men, they're hardened men, and they're receiving the just reward for the evil they have spread in the world. One of the criminals is bent on being who he is, and he's demanding something that he doesn't deserve. Notice in his words, there's no sense of repentance. There's no sense of identification. He's not going to recognize all that Jesus is and the fact that he doesn't deserve to be there. He just looks at him and says, "If you're the Christ, then you save yourself and us." There is a mocking tone to his voice. He's asking for something he doesn't deserve and he really isn't seeking. He's just continuing the jeers. He's just continuing the tenor of hatred. You know, it's interesting, at the cross they labeled him the King of the Jews. He was rightly that, but Jesus was so much more. When they put that sign on his cross, King of the Jews, and when they put the crown of thorns on his head, which they drove in through the skin to his skull, when they hailed him king, it wasn't a recognition of authority. It was a mocking, derisive way of saying, if you think you're so special, stop us. And he didn't. You see, that wasn't the plan. And like the rich young ruler, this man voiced what so many think. I deserve something better. Look at all I've done. And you're so special, Jesus. Just give me your blessing too. And Jesus doesn't. It's interesting that the other criminal sees things as they are. And he makes this simple statement that says, we are getting what we deserve. If you got what you deserve this morning, where would you be? I mean, honestly, if this morning, instead of sitting in this sanctuary or watching online with us, you received everything that you were due, if justice finally caught up with you for the past or even maybe the present life you're living, what would you do? For how many of us would that one thing bring judgment and condemnation? For how many of us would we not find grace and mercy, but judgment, imprisonment, a cross? You see, this other criminal, he understood. He figured it out. That they were where they deserved to be. They had been rightly accused, rightly convicted, and rightly condemned to die. And realizing all that he had done, he makes this simple confession, and it's powerful. I deserve what I'm getting. But not Jesus. He's done nothing wrong. And what he said has really become for many a faith maxim. He paid a debt he didn't owe because we had a debt we couldn't pay. And this second man, who knows something of Jesus, who he is and what he's offered to others, dares to ask for what he didn't deserve. Jesus, would you just remember me? Do you remember the day you first submitted to Jesus? You asked him to forgive you of your sins. You asked him if he would wipe your slate clean and give you the gift of eternal life. That's what this guy's doing. He's recognized who he is. He has confessed that Jesus didn't deserve what he was getting. And now he's saying, Lord Jesus, would you just remember me? Something tells me that this criminal had been perhaps a follower somewhere along the way. He'd probably witnessed some of the miracles. He'd probably heard some of the messages. He'd probably seen Jesus do some amazing things. And his simple confession, his simple cry, remember me, echoes what Paul writes about in Romans chapter 5, when at verse 6 he says, while we're still helpless at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. One will hardly die for a righteous man, though perhaps for a good man someone would dare even to die. But God demonstrates his own love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I deserve everything I'm getting. You don't, Jesus. Would you remember me? And the response of Jesus is exactly what you would expect from someone whose life mission it was to love and to share hope instead of hostility and judgment and condemnation. I love John 3:17. John 3:17 says to us that God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that through him the world might be saved. Verse 43 and in Luke 23 says, today, this very hour, you will be with me in paradise. There was no hesitation. There was no demand for something more. Jesus looked at him, no doubt, with eyes of mercy and grace and said, because you have asked, I will give you what I alone can give. Hope in the midst of hostility. Grace in place of judgment. Love in the face of open condemnation. Today, there was no hesitation. This man didn't have to prove that he was worthy because everybody in the world knew he wasn't. And he surrendered. And it brings to mind that simple truth that when we need him the most, Jesus is right there. And that truth begs us to answer the question, will we open our hearts to him? What is your one thing? Because if we learn anything from these stories, and especially Luke 23, it is this: today, right now, this moment, you can experience hope in the face of condemnation. What do you deserve? If you got what you've earned, what would the outcome be? The wages of sin are always death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. Last Sunday, I shared a simple truth that said that when we encounter Jesus, he meets our needs as we perceive them, but he also meets the needs that he sees in our hearts. He goes beyond what we think our problem is and says, I want to help you here too. There have been times in my life when I've come to the Lord thinking I knew exactly what I needed. And he simply said, well, you know, that's part of the issue, but what about... I had one of those this week. I just had an attitude that was really a point of struggle for me. It was just difficult. And I thought I had done everything I needed to do to take care of that attitude, and I'd talked to people and I'd got counsel and I'd read scripture, and I was feeling like it should have been taken care of. And I'm in my office at home and I'm praying and I'm just waiting before the Lord, and I just sense this little voice saying, so, you've tried to fix it all. How's that working for you? And it wasn't. Just saying. And And I heard the Lord say, would you give it to me? And before I ever brought this message to you, I had to deal with this truth that when we need him the most, he's there. But for him to do what he wants to do, I have to open my heart to him. Now, it's real interesting. In that moment, I said, okay, God, I give it to you. You can have it. Now, most of you have seen this little illustration that I use, but I like to use it because it really kind of helps me understand how God wants us to respond. A lot of times we give things to the Lord, and when we do it, we say, okay, Lord, here it is. I give you my one thing. You can have it. And we give it to the Lord palms up, thinking that that's the best way to do it. The only problem with giving things to God palms up is we can take them back because they're still there in our palm. And the Lord taught me long ago that when you give something to him, you give it to him palms down. Because once it's gone, it's gone. And I can leave it there. There's an old hymn that says, take your burden to the Lord and leave it there. Leave it there. Leave it there. Last Sunday, I shared with you that when we encounter Jesus, he not only meets our needs as we perceive them, but he also meets the needs he sees in our hearts. For the rich young ruler, the fact that his possessions commanded the allegiance of his heart would not allow him to truly follow Jesus, and so instead he walked away. He just couldn't let go of the one thing. And in this second last word from the cross, two men deserving death come to Jesus, one demanding what he was unwilling to admit he needed, the other asking for what he knew he did not deserve. One received just recompense for the life that he had lived. The other was ushered into paradise with the Lord Jesus. You know, we're all captured in this story. Every one of us. Every single one of us is captured in this story. Every single one of us is one of those criminals on the cross, either the one demanding what we're not willing to really do to get, or we're the one who's asking for what we know we don't deserve. What's your one thing? And you see, that truth changes very quickly. From when we need him the most, Jesus is here. And through the whole message, I've said, but will we open our hearts to him? Now I'm going to change it and ask the question to make it really personal. Will you open your heart to him? Don't look around and figure out who's going to do it. Ask yourself the simple question. Is there one thing that keeps me from a vital relationship with Jesus Christ, that holds me back? Is there one thing that I need to willingly and willfully, palms down, give to the Lord? I want to ask you to bow your heads this morning. Close your eyes with no one looking around. And in this moment of quiet reflection, I want you to ask the Lord a question. Where am I in this story from the cross? Where am I in this story of the rich young ruler? Is there one thing, maybe more, that I've just never really surrendered, that I've just never really given, that I really must if I'm going to be the follower of Jesus he's called me to be? Is there anybody here this morning that would have to just say very simply, no physical sign, don't raise a hand, don't look up, don't do anything to tell me that you're responding yet. I just want you to answer the simple question, is there something God's asking you to do? Is there something God's asking you for? Is there something he's asking you to surrender? Is there one thing? You know, maybe you've been hurt. Maybe someone has hurt you so deeply and the scars are so raw that you just don't think you can get past it. Maybe that's your one thing. Did you know that he has grace to heal the brokenhearted? That there is mercy to set those who are captive there free? Maybe it's a choice you've made along the way. Something you really know you shouldn't have done, but you did anyway. And even though you knew it broke the heart of God, and even though you know it kind of broke your heart that you did it anyway, and it for you is sin. He's here right now saying, I'm willing to forgive that. Would you surrender it to me? Maybe there's one thing that nobody knows about. Something from the past, something in the present that's just holding you back. Could you give him the one thing? I believe this morning that there are many here who really would just love to say to the Lord Jesus, would you just remember me? And if that's you this morning, with no fanfare, no music, no other pressure from the preacher, would you just be willing to get up from where you are and come to an altar, a place where we do business with God? We just come and we just say, God, I'm here to pray and to meet with you and to allow you to speak, to allow me to release. Would you be willing just to stand up from where you are and slip out of that pew and come to an altar? Would you just say, Lord, remember me? Is there anybody here this morning that feels they just need to do that? And if so, would you just slip out and come now? God bless you and you. Any others this morning who just want to say, Lord, remember me? Father, this is one of these holy moments when you come in quiet and gentle ways and you speak to our hearts. In my spirit, I feel that there are people wrestling this morning. Maybe think they're not ready to let go. Would you speak to them and remind them that the longer they wait, the worse things get and the harder it is to say, Jesus, remember me, and to receive the grace that he longs to give. Lord, whenever we give an altar call, we recognize that there are some who are bashful. They just don't want anybody to know that they have a need. So they try to deal with it quietly and often put it off and never come back to that moment where they say, Lord, would you remember me? If there's one who's struggling that way this morning, would you give them the conviction that says, I can't wait any longer, I have to deal with it now, and help them just to slip out and come to a place of prayer and say, Lord, remember me. Help us, Lord Jesus. And hear our prayers. And as we just continue in quiet this morning without a benediction, without the pastor saying the service is over, allowing those who would to pray, allowing those who would to sit here and to contemplate, allowing those who would to continue to examine, would you just quietly minister to us? And release us, God, in your time, not ours. And Father, for all that you're doing, for all that you've done, for all that you will yet do this day, we give you praise. In Jesus' name.